Jason Rubin, welcome to the Game Informer show, sir.
Thank you. Pleasure to be the first in studio, I guess, in the podcast.
Yeah, if you're wondering why Jason sounds so good and isn't a pixelated version on the screen for the YouTube version, he's actually here in person.
I've come here, yes,
in person. To show us a bunch of VR stuff.
I've come here live to be streamed to somebody else.
That's right. Yeah, we know how to do it. Not in VR yet for this podcast.
That's right.
Old 2D video. Sorry, everybody.
It's sooner or later we will do this in 3D VR. You see everything going on over there, which I can tell you is incredibly exciting. It's like a party, hundreds of people. It's
nonstop, elephants marching.
That's right.
Constantly behind
camels,
the cameras.
Yeah, exactly.
So what are you showing here today? What are you here for?
We are here showing off the various Oculus VR products, including Gear VR, which is launching on the 20th of November. By the time people hear this, is probably out live in stores. $99, Best Buy, you know, online, Amazon or whatever. Shove in a Samsung phone and you have a fully portable, amazing VR experience. And that's powered by Oculus. Hardware is by Samsung, as well as the Rift, which is our kind of premier in-house product that hooks up to a PC that will be out first quarter of 16.
So with Gear VR, I'm sure you've been asked this a million times, so I'm sorry, but I actually don't know the answer to it. Is there any chance it could come to an iPhone or, you know, iPhone Plus or anything like that?
There's always a chance.
Okay.
The reason we've partnered with Samsung, there's many reasons, but the biggest reason is to do VR right with a cell phone, you need to basically reroute the OS.
Okay.
And to do that, you need a partner who controls the OS, as Samsung does on all of their phones. The other thing is Samsung is the largest phone seller in the world after Apple, so it gives you an opportunity to hit a massive market. If you want to do it right, you partner with the hardware manufacturer of the phone. If you want to just kind of do it, you can do something a little more like some of our competitors that have done, where any phone works and you can shove it into something, whatever it is, but it's not going to give you the same experience. The latency will be higher. You don't know where the lenses are exactly. Everything kind of is wrong. What we've done is kind of the high-end mobile experience.
Nice. So there's that version. How do you differentiate between the audiences for Gear VR versus Rift?
Gear VR is an amazing entry into VR. If you have a Samsung phone, any 2015 phone, it'll work with it. So if you have the phone, it's a $99 entry point.
It's pretty good.
It's mobile. You can stream Netflix onto it, sit in a virtual theater and watch Netflix, Hulu. There's a ton of video stuff on it, 360 videos. So you can sit wherever you are in the video and look around in any direction and kind of see what's going on around you, which is an amazing experience. They're streaming front row games, basketball games. That's the video side of it. On the game side of it, we have really great games. They are far more than you think could come out of a mobile phone, and they're 3D, they're stereo, and they're 360 all around you. So, a nice launch lineup that's out there and continual support. And all on a phone that, you already have, effectively.
That sounds good. You mind if we jump into the past a little bit, Jason?
Sure.
Okay. I'm really thrilled that you're here, specifically because I sent you an email in 1997, and you responded to it. And it was the highlight of my life back then.
I try to respond to every email I get. It's the right thing to do.
It's insane.
So what did you send me? What was it?
So I'm a huge Crash Bandicoot fan, right? And I was also just head over heels over Final Fantasy VII and like jumping back in all these RPGs and whatnot. And
yeah, those were good days, 97, 98. There's a lot of good games in those eras.
Yeah,
era,
turns
right?
out you're behind a couple of them there, so congratulations.
Thank you.
But I was super excited about the idea of like, oh my God, they made that Mario RPG for Super Nintendo, like Crash Bandicoot RPG. It'd just be the best. You get a sister in there, get the girlfriend, you got plenty of characters.
Yeah.
So I sent this dumb pitch to you guys, and then you or Andy, I guess I don't know specifically who it was, somebody at Naughty Dog responded and said like, oh, that's so nice. Hey, by the way, if you like RPGs, we made Rings of Power a little while ago. You should totally check that out. It was a very flattering email, and I really, really appreciated it.
Cool.
So it's an honor to now sit across the podcast table with you, man.
No problem. It's an honor to be here. So
I'm sure the Crash Bandicoot days and the early Naughty Dog days get brought up all the time. Do you find yourself thinking about that era a lot?
Yeah. I mean, it was crazy times. We went from Andy and I, my business partner, we went from making games that were, they were good games, but not that many people played them, to overnight going up against probably the greatest video game creator ever, that's ever been in video games, Miyamoto-san, and having people compare our games and contrast our games. We ended up outselling him in the PlayStation era. And it, you know, it was a lot going on, but it was also 24-hour days almost, 7 days a week. I remember 1998, about that time,
yeah.
I had one day out of the office. I was sick. Andy had 0 days out of the office, including holidays. It doesn't, you say, what about this? What about, we were there every day. We were working on Silicon Graphics machines, and they tracked your day, your hours.
Okay.
16-hour average days. So work that out. You're in there 16-hour average day. You're in there 12 hours one day, which is a long day. You got to be in there 20 another. So it was absolutely insane time. But great, great memories. You know, going on world tours, talking about the launch of Crash, meeting people who had played the game. It was amazing. I mean, that's why you get into video games as a game maker, is to make people happy. And a lot of people were happy with the Crash games.
How do you run a company like Naughty Dog back then, where you guys are working so hard? It's just you set that pace car and then all your employees are like, well, I guess we got to keep up with this.
Yeah, we were all, you know, it just coincidentally, we were all young. We were all single, except for Charlotte, who had a husband. And we were just burning the midnight oil. You know, we had a vision. We had a dream. We thought we could create one of the best games of the, you know, of the year or whatever. And we ended up doing it. And I know Naughty Dog still works in that way. You know, there are teams out there who have transitioned into a more modern 8 to 8 hour day, call it 10 hour day crunch, but not huge crunch. Naughty Dog still is absolutely dead set on doing whatever it takes to make the best game that they can make, and still works those crazy hours. Eventually it wore me out. I just, you know, around 2004, I just couldn't take it anymore. I had been doing it for a decade.
Did it get a little bit better when you had more employees for the Jack and Daxter series, though?
Parts of it got better. Certainly, the games, we could do a lot more. But parts of it got worse. The video game industry was an industry off on its own. It had to figure itself out. And it started in basements and garages. Andy and I came at it. We never got training in doing what we were doing. I never took management school. I didn't go to business school. We learned how to manage people basically on the job and how... When you have your first employee, which Crash Bandicoot was the first game we had to have an employee, how to manage an employee? Well, the way you manage an employee is you manage that employee. And if you have 10 employees, you manage 10 employees. And when we got up to 80, 90 people on the Jack and Daxter games, I basically had 55 people reporting to me. So I would go out with the artists, anyone that wasn't a programmer that Andy was managing, and say, okay, I need to know what everybody's doing today, whether they're on schedule, if their work is up to quality. And it was insane. And I didn't know that the industry was going to figure out what every other industry has figured out, which is you need some sort of hierarchy. You need some sort of, you know, pyramid structure where the managers report to the managers who report to the executives. And that way you don't have to go to everybody's desk every day. But at the time, nobody in the industry was managing that way. Teams were expanding like crazy. We saw the PlayStation 3 coming out and the size of the teams that would need to be made. And it just one of those moments where I didn't see the future, and it didn't strike me that I could say to one of my artists, you're now the lead artist. I want you to know what everybody's doing on the art staff, and I'm going to come to you, and it's your ass if you're not on schedule, but all of them, I don't need to speak to them every day. I obviously want to speak to them. They're great employees, they're great people, but I can't possibly manage more than the 55 people. And so it had gotten to this point where I just didn't see the next change.
So, I mean, you go to GDC back then, you go to E3, don't you talk to other teams and figure out how they're structured? Or is it just nobody in the industry was
structured
that way?
Nobody in the industry did that. About 4 years before that, I remember that I walked into work one day and I went over to somebody's desk and I said, how are we doing on, it was probably the main, I think it was the main character, right? How are we doing on Jack? And he said, well, you know, it's really tough because I come in and I work and the programmer that's assisting me is never here. I go, what do you mean he's never here? Everybody works like crazy, not here. Well, you know, I come in at 4 a.m. because I want to leave at 4 p.m. because I have a kid that I want to see when he or she comes home from school. And that's my hours. And he's up all night and he comes in rolling in at 3. He stays till 4 a.m, but I never see him. And I thought, this is not going to work. So we're going to have to institute some sort of policy here. I know this sounds obvious, but nobody in the industry was doing it. I'm going to make what I'm going to call core hours. You have to be here from 10:30 to 12:30, and then from 2 to 5. Like, it doesn't even add up to an 8-hour day. It's just you can have lunch in the middle, but those hours you have to be here. And if we do that, some people come late, some people come early, but yeah. At least they can work together. I lost an employee the day I instituted. He said, I will never work at a company with such draconian policies. I lost another employee a few weeks later because he couldn't adjust to it. Nobody else in the industry had done it. Everybody was complaining when I set it up and said, we're going to go to other teams. Within 2 years, every team in the industry of our scale had that policy, not because we came up with it. Yeah. Everyone came up with it at the same time, right? Everybody just figured this isn't going to work anymore. We can't act like teenagers in a garage. We have to act like adults. And the same exact thing happened in the industry where all the big teams were horribly flat managed. And then all of a sudden, everyone realized at the same time, we can't get to the next level if we don't do it. And the teams that don't figure that stuff out fail.
Except for Valve. How do you account for that?
You account for that in they have endless money and no deadlines.
Oh, I see. That's an easy excuse.
Right. Okay. So if they don't, you know, if the work doesn't get done, it doesn't get done. The game doesn't come out this year.
Right. No big deal. But you make it seem like that should have been 1975 that was figured out. But it's what, 2000, 2001, you're saying, before structure came in?
Because the game industry was a unique industry that grew up with a unique set of individuals who, for the most part, learned the skill on the job. None of us had any background in other things.
Right.
Right. And call us dumb, we were focused on the game. We just didn't think about management style.
Yeah.
We didn't read all the books that are out there now. There wasn't, the internet was there, but you didn't really go to look for management tips or how to run a business. Like, I never thought like that. I was a game maker. That's all I did.
So what do you like to consider yourself now?
A developer, always a developer. So that's, I still consider myself a game developer, although I haven't developed a game in a long time. I guess you could call me a producer now, because I'm kind of out there making sure the games that come to our various VR platforms, Oculus's platforms, are great. And I'm not working day to day on the projects, but I still think of myself as a developer. I don't think that'll ever change.
I mean, it must be satisfying though to still kind of, I don't know, scratch those creative itches by having so many creative conversations with so many studios. Are you getting the trenches a fair amount?
Not as much as I could.
Okay.
And we have a lot of projects going on, so it's hard. I'm in kind of a perfect position now because I get to have the brainstorms and get all the excitement of the discovery and the beauty of game development without the core hours and without the frustration, right? I can kind of helicopter out and look at the team as they're doing what they're doing and not have to sweat through it with them, but then get to go in and at least internalize the success. Although beyond any shadow of a doubt, I would never take credit for any of the successes that these teams are going to come through with. And VR is really starting over in game development. I mean, there's certainly things we've learned in the last 30, 40 years of game development that are very relevant.
Right.
But a lot of it has to be relearned from scratch. And a lot of the rules that we've built up over years are not valuable and not useful in VR.
So are you coming in with like a Bible of do's and don'ts then? Like, hey, we've learned this much about VR developers. Just this might help you out a little bit. Otherwise, it's the Wild West. Go nuts.
We started with a Bible. Here's what we believe absolutely won't work, and found out very quickly that you can get around the edges of it, and you can't say you can never move the camera or somebody's not going to feel comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are cases where you can move the camera and people will feel comfortable. So what we've started to say is comfort is the absolute utmost importance. Experiment at will, right?
Hmm.
So do whatever you think might work, but if it doesn't work, back off it if it's not comfortable. So and that's really a lot of what our development learning is around that comfort.
What are some of the big mistakes you think maybe that VR has kind of already tackled? Some of the things we're going to be like, definitely don't do this.
Well, early VR, the DK1 and the DK2, our first two devices, they didn't really have the technical minimum to create the presence that's so important, what we call presence, which is kind of a feeling that we've tricked your eyes, you're mm-hmm. elsewhere, and you kind of buy into it. It's different for every person, but you know it when you feel it. And a lot of the decisions that were made early on in the business about what would and wouldn't work were made based on these somewhat, not flawed, but early systems. And I think we've had to take the Rift, the final version, and start over because it is of a high enough quality that a lot of things that we didn't think would work or were suspicious of actually end up working okay.
Do you have examples of what kind of stuff that is?
Sure. For example, in general, you don't want the character's head motion or the character's vision to not be one-to-one to what they would expect in the real world. So in other words, if I turn 90 degrees to the right, you have to turn the camera in the game 90 degrees to the right. You can't do something wacky where, for example, if I turn 90 degrees, it's only going 45 degrees because you want to increase the person's firing ability or something. Nor if I move my head a foot forward, can I go 6 feet forward in the game? Because as soon as you do something that isn't one-to-one, you feel uncomfortable. And therefore, a sniper rifle is never going to work. Because as soon as you go into a sniper rifle, you're now zoomed way in. And if you rotate a little bit, it's not going to work. So we started working on first-person shooters, and you didn't want to have a lot of locomotion, and we also didn't want to have sniper rifles. And then we realized that that doesn't really make sense, because I can look at a TV on a wall, an Xbox, a PlayStation 4, and have crazy stuff going on and not feel sick. I can go to a movie theater or ride a roller coaster on a movie theater and not feel at all bad, even though I'm not moving in my movie theater seat. And, you know, here I am in a spaceship or whatever, zipping around the world. So if a screen works, why wouldn't a picture-in-picture sniper scope work? And literally, there were people who said it just isn't going to work. So we tried it. It works fine. And we have a game called Damage Core, which uses a sniper scope that's awesome, high comfort rating. And other game developers have seen that sniper scope and have started to do other interesting things with picture-in-picture. So we didn't know that we'd have that ability. All of a sudden, we had that ability. We said to the Senzaru, one of our great teams, is working on a sports game. We said, don't cut the camera too often. Well, it turns out in the football game that they're making, they cut the camera all the time. They just have learned how to do it, so it's totally comfortable. And there are little tricks that it's hard to explain in a microphone, but if you get shot on in the hockey game from the right, you're looking to the right. So if you miss and there's a goal, the camera that shows your character reacting to it has to be behind you to the left so that you're looking to the right at yourself. Right. Otherwise, the camera cuts and you're seeing nothing. You know, you don't know what you're looking at, and you have to look around to find what we want you to look at. So it sounds easy, but it took them weeks and weeks of messing around before they got that to work. And every developer that sees that builds upon it. It's exactly the way the entire video game industry has been built, with little discoveries. Doom becomes Quake, becomes, right? John Carmack on the Oculus team has been through this before. I've been through this before. Except it's accelerated, because now you have hundreds of teams working on it. It's not the cottage industry it was back in the 90s. It's the video game industry, huge business, very competitive, extremely smart people attracted to it. So it's accelerated, but it's the same thing. Somebody discovers something, the next person steps on that, the next person uses it to get a little higher, and very quickly VR is going to find its world and create games that right now we wouldn't think would work.
So is that the appeal? Is that why people like John Carmack and you are attracted to VR? Is just because it reminds you guys a little bit of those garage days?
It reminds us of trying to figure out how to make games work.
Because I remember there's like an awesome blog about the creation of Crash Bandicoot that I think Andy started. I think you contributed to a little bit, but you called it the Sonic's ass problem.
Right.
Where it's like, oh, we want to have the camera behind the character, but we don't want to be looking at Sonic's ass the entire time. How do we solve for that?
Yep.
And it's just that level of just grassroots again.
People don't realize how much the hardware and the technology of the day plays into the video game. The reason that Mario 64 was able to be free roaming was because Miyamoto was able to dictate to Nintendo to do an analog stick. It was the first analog stick. Sony didn't do an analog stick. We had a digital stick on the first PlayStation. Mm-hmm. Had up, down, left, right, and the wonky 45-degree angles that you could never quite get right.
Yeah.
Try to make a character action game where you're using a D-pad to go the 45-degree angles in 3D. Doesn't work. It's just very frustrating. So Crash goes up, down, left, and right in, out. That's what he does because that was the hardware.
Right.
Figuring that out took us a year of R&D and all the little nuances that go with that. At the same time, Miyamoto was figuring out the same problem with one major difference, the analog stick, and ended up with a totally different game.
So what's the appeal then? You just feel like you're making progress and affecting an entire medium, and that's the thrill for you personally?
Yeah, it feels like being back at square one, able to reinvent things and do something that we really don't know where the frontier is leading, but we can push the frontier forward every day and learn something every day.
So where is the frontier leading?
That's a really good question. I still don't know the answer to that. I think VR over the next 3 to 5 years is going to really just night and day change every couple of months. There's going to be some new discovery, and then we're going to kind of figure out best practices for doing the various things we want to do. What's the best way to move people in first person? What's the best way to move people in third person? What things that have never been done before, does VR suddenly do? In fact, that's the hardest part of my job. I started really, you know, getting into Rift development and gear development about a year ago. And that's not a long time in development, right? And we're launching pretty soon. So we had to have games done. And you want to do brand new things that nobody's ever seen before. In a year and a little, it's not even easy to do a port. And a lot of ports just don't work. So even if you want to do a port, you have to figure out how to make it work in VR correctly and make it better because it's using VR. But to say you have a year, figure out something that no one's ever done before, go, is crazy. So I think those titles will come, you know, second, third year. Certainly there will be a lot of really cool things to do in the first year, but we're going to just be blown away in the second and third year as the wider development community gets out there and starts playing with it.
It's interesting. Like I played a demo today, which was Epic's Bullet Train, which I think people have seen footage of, and they tried to solve the movement problem by having you teleport. So you hold down a button, you can see different spots you can jump to.
Right.
It's an interesting idea, but my instinct when I was playing it was, well, this is novel right now. I can't wait for 5 years from now when this is laughable.
Yeah. So the first person shooter we did, internally was you can't move. You're standing in place. Things come at you. It's basically you're a turret.
Right.
And it's actually quite fun. A lot of, you know, in real life, a lot of stuff is you're stuck here. They're coming at you. Defend yourself. So it's not like you can't make a game around that. But clearly that wasn't going to be the history of VR, you know, first person shoot. Then we had warp from one place to another infrequently. I would characterize Bullet Train as warp from one place to another more frequently. We now have a concept that's been put into play called tunneling, which is impossible to describe. It is actually available for download and on the Oculus Share store, and you can find a video of it online. But in effect, it allows you to play a standard first-person shooter in a window, and then when you stop, it becomes full VR. And I don't know how to explain that well, except for to say, if you're standing somewhere, you can look around completely. But when you move from point A to point B, you kind of move in a window. And you suddenly aren't warping. You're back to moving through a window, which, by the way, is exactly how Battlefield Call of Duty work. So if you think, well, that's restrictive, it's actually just as good as any first-person shooter is, with the exception that you get VR when you stop.
But I don't, isn't it, it reminds me more of like the old Resident Evil, like you can move or you can shoot, right? Isn't that more what it's like?
It's kind of like, yes, you can move and you can shoot.
Okay.
So it's not the end of where first-person shooters are going, but it's the progression past warping.
Mm-hmm.
And once somebody institutes that, somebody else will say, oh, you know, you could shoot while you're moving, and here's how you do it. And you could actually do better than a window, and here's how you do it, and here, or here's a totally new idea.
Right.
And so that's why I can't predict where we'll be in a few years. Because even this year, I've seen first-person shooters go from you can't move through a couple iterations to Bullet Train. I know what the next thing coming out is going to be, and people are working on it. I have no idea what's going to be 2-3 years from now, what comes out, nor what we'll settle on. Let me put it to you this way.
Sure.
Doom, the gun was fixed right in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
You ran around, and people were saying when Doom came out, John remembers this, I remember this, first-person shooters are never going to work. People feel sick. They can't play the games. And to this day, some people feel sick playing first-person shooters.
Yep.
Go look at Battlefield or Call of Duty or any one of the big games now. You're shaking around like someone's grabbing you and throwing you around. Your legs show up on screen. You climb ladders. You fall down. You can fall off a building and spiral down. And they figured all of this out over 20 years to the point where they can do almost anything to you and create this incredible experience. And it's awesome. And it was just built up. But if you step back for a second and you watch what's going on screen, it makes absolutely no sense. Your legs are these weird puppet legs that fly up in front of you. Your arms are always weird. Your gun's like, you know, it doesn't
right in
really,
your face.
Right.
Yeah.
It makes no sense for reality. It makes a fantastic game. We're in the Doom stage right now in VR. It works. People are saying, but it works. And we'll get to the Call of Duty stage in the same in the same method they did. One game was better, the next game was better, the next game was better. Someone figured out how to get it to work on an analog stick, Halo or GoldenEye, depending on who you give credit for that. Like, it's just these little bits of stepping on each other's shoulders and rising higher and higher in the industry will lead to God knows what, but an amazing game.
Yeah. So is just locomotion alone, is that the biggest design challenge? Plenty of challenges when it comes to marketing this thing and actually getting in people's eyeballs and whatnot. But design-wise, is it just locomotion? Is that number one?
From a game design standpoint, comfort, more broadly speaking, is the number one issue. And locomotion is a big part of that. There are other things such as getting 3D objects too close to your face and having your eyes cross to converge as they would naturally, and that doesn't really work. On screens that are a challenge, so you try to keep things away from you. There's a lot of nuances to comfort. but you could generalize and say locomotion plus a bunch of other little things are the challenge. And a lot of them have answers as technology gets better. Locomotion's a big challenge.
It's got to be so hard, but you're a creative guy. I'd imagine you spend a lot of time thinking about this. And also you have an interesting perspective because you're the hub of this bicycle wheel, basically, of all these different studios trying to solve these problems. So you're kind of the connective tissue. Do you cross-pollinate ideas? Do you stay up at night trying to solve these problems on your own?
It's a combination of all the things. Within reason, we're cross-pollinating. I don't think I've seen this, by the way, since the early 90s or mid-90s. The camaraderie and the sharing of information, those that are developing earlier in VR, is amazing. And it reminds me of the early days of video games where it's like, we're not really competing so much as all enjoying what we do, and we're pushing the art forward, and we have plenty of time to compete later, but right now, let's just all kind of help each other out. That's amazing. So there is definitely a lot of sharing going around. I mean, there are rules. I can't take somebody's idea and hand it to somebody else as soon as it's been shown in a trade show. Or if they say it's okay, that's fine. But you can't just see an idea one day and give it to another developer another day. Some of it I think of on my own. I have producers that are extremely talented. They're thinking of it on their own. Sometimes people I'm not working with at all, independents that are submitting small prototypes to our share store or doing just little demos, come up with absolutely brilliant answers to things. And then the big developers, you know, slap themselves in the head and say, why didn't we come up with that? So it's coming from all directions. It's a fantastic time to be making games because it doesn't have the same pressure of 2015 console or 2015 PC.
Interesting.
It's fun, it's happy, it's exploration. It's not yet the competition for the dollar that eventually will come, I'm sure, to any business, but right now it's not there.
It's going to be interesting for you too, coming from THQ, where it's the ultimate pressure of the dollar, right? Yes. Then moving back into the Wild West. Does that feel like a relief to you to get out of the hard pressure business world again?
Well, yeah. I went to THQ because I thought, there are some amazing teams here. The company's in distress, but if I can bring the company through the financial bad spot they're in, the teams eventually will make incredible product and there'll be a value here. And unfortunately, we don't have to get into it today. That didn't quite happen. What I did manage to do is save pretty much without exception all the development teams from disbanding. They're all working on various things. And a lot of them are now working with Oculus in VR. So Gunfire guys who used to be Vigil.
Oh, sure.
Are working on products for us. 4A working on products for us. So a lot of the teams that I worked with back then, the relationships were great. And they were very interested, you know, when I came knocking to see VR. And you put a Rift headset on any developer anywhere in the world and they want to work in VR. That's the easiest sell you'll ever have to make.
Yeah. And so you're brought on board. I mean, when were you brought on board to Oculus? When did that come about?
June of last year.
All right. And they realized, like, this guy has great relationships all around the world because of THQ. You were trying to save studios, so you have a good impression in all their minds. And now your job is just to fly around and put these helmets on people and try and evangelize, basically. Is that the idea?
Yeah. It's to put headsets on people, and that sells itself. Like, at that point, you've sold a developer, right? They really want to work in it. Look, we all got into the business to create worlds and to create alternate universes. That's why we got into video game making. And nothing comes close to video games to actually transport somebody somewhere else for as long. You could say a movie transports you. I don't want to, you know, diminish the other art forms that are out there. But nobody spends the amount of time in a movie that they do in a Skyrim or a Fallout or you know, Call of Duty or Battlefield, any of these titles, right? Being able to actually put them in that universe to the point where they believe, their eyes believe they're there, is what every developer has been waiting for, whether they knew it or not, since they got in the industry. So the minute you put that on their head, they're all in.
So you talk about being immersed in this world. I feel like maybe it's just a matter of where VR is right now, where no one's spent too much time in it, but to feel confident that people are going to be spending, I don't know, take Skyrim for an example, spending 100 hours with an Oculus device on their head?
I have absolutely no doubt that people will spend 100 hours in games eventually in VR.
Eventually.
So we've been building games on this hardware for about a year.
Right.
Skyrim is not built in a year. Games like that are built over multiple years. So the practicality of team size and time will keep us from making a Skyrim in the next year or two. We just haven't had enough time with the hardware. So to get a game that you want to play for 100 hours, Forget for a moment what you're asking, which is, do your eyes get tired or anything like that? Just creating a game that you want to play for 100 hours on any medium takes years. It just does.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll take a while for VR. When we get there, I have no fear that there will be a lot of people who spend many, many hours in a row in VR. I have, and depending on the game, others are capable of doing that as well. There are some games that are very intense. VR has an ability to be intense in a way that no other medium does. You can look away from a horror movie. You can't look away from VR. It's all around. You can close your eyes, but when you open them, you're looking back wherever you were. You can't, mm-hmm. You're in there. So it's very intense. And I would suggest that people love roller coasters, but nobody wants to ride a roller coaster for 90 minutes.
Right.
So there will be titles in VR that are as intense as a roller coaster, and you love them. You just can't do them for that long.
Mm-hmm.
There aren't that many things that I can think of in games or movies that are like that. But in VR, that will be the case. A more mellow game, you can certainly play for longer.
Lucky's Tale seemed great. I would like to play through that entire thing.
Absolutely.
Has a Crash vibe to it as well.
Our CEO played through Lucky's Tale. Brendan played through Lucky's Tale in one sitting.
Oh, nice.
And that was well over, multiple hours. So
yeah.
You can easily be in VR for more than an hour.
You talked about something like the THQ... holdovers that are now working in VR, but are there other big studios you want to call out? Like who's building for VR now? That'd be interesting to gamers out there.
A lot of people that unfortunately we haven't announced their projects, so I really can't, but we have announced Insomniac, which is a pretty big studio.
Yeah.
Take-Two's name's been on a couple of our, or 2K's names have been on a couple of our announcements. Square Enix, There are a bunch of very big studios that are out there working on things.
Ready at Dawn, I think they announced their...
Ready at Dawn is working with us as well, yeah. So they're out there working with us. I mean, there are a significant number of large studios. The challenge we have to a certain extent is when you're a really, really large studio and you're under a significant deadline to make your next billion-dollar release, it's hard to focus on something else even if you want to.
Mm-hmm.
But I think as VR launches, inevitably those teams are going to have to take a look. Otherwise, they'll fall behind in the same way that teams that stayed in 2D too long couldn't catch up in 3D. Teams that didn't get involved early or publishers that didn't get involved early on mobile ended up having to acquire teams that had gone out and learned how to make things work on mobile. I think the same thing will happen in VR. And because of that, and because of the fact that they did miss the boat in VR, a lot of the big publishers are saying, we're not going to be waiting this one out. We're going to get involved in this. It's also much closer to their core competency. It's hardcore games you can make in it. It's not, mobile was a lot of hardcore gamers said, this isn't what we do. VR is going to be what they do.
Yeah. So how does the pitch process work? Are they pitching to you? Are you in a good spot to be able to give a thumbs up, thumbs down? Is Palmer Luckey getting in there saying, I really want a game like this, find me a studio for it? How does this flow work?
All of the above. And okay. It's important to notice that, or to note that Oculus is very much like a Sony or a Microsoft. There are games that are being made by third parties that we don't have any idea exist until they come to us and say, we'd like to publish this.
Right.
Right. So they're not funded by us. They're not managed by us. They're not produced by us. They're very talented teams out there who bring us near final products and say, hey, we've been working in VR on your hardware and we want to bring this out. I think Eve Valkyrie came to us early, but that's a perfect example, CCP, of a team that went and did something in VR that had no push from Oculus and came to us and we were like, holy cow, this is amazing. This is incredible. We really want to support you on this. It's fantastic. As far as Oculus goes, we're out there constantly talking to the development community. I run the studios group, which actually funds things and produces things, but we have a developer relationship group that spends a huge amount of time out there just talking to studios and talking to developers who don't need money. They don't need help. Mm-hmm. They're completely self-starting and they're out there working on their own projects.
It's got to be really satisfying for you after the Facebook purchase and whatnot to just be in a place where you can make games happen and you know all these people because you've been in the industry forever. And you can be like, I know exactly the most talented teams out there. I can help out, not necessarily my friends, but the most talented individuals out there. And I have a Brinks truck full of money hauling behind me. It's got to be great, right?
Money has not been a problem. Our challenge is really simple. Time and the intellectual property of figuring out how to make things work in VR. The tech, right? The tech, we would love to be 3 years ahead in what we knew about VR. Mm-hmm. It's going to take 3 years to get there by nature. And it takes multiple years to make games. So my biggest challenge is time and learning about things in VR. I like to say, if I suddenly said, I'm going to start this 3-year project. And I started it. A year from now, I'd have to cancel it because somebody would have come up with a better day, a better way of doing whatever the core is, and we'd have to start over.
Right.
So to start a massive project now makes no sense. We're learning too fast.
Interesting. What a weird spot to be in. So when you're actually going out and courting people, are you looking for licenses? Is that a good way to get VR out there right out of the gate? Just for like, hey, bring your beloved character onto this platform, please. Is that a big part of your discussion?
Licenses are great. But I think the as far as Rift goes, as far as Rift goes, the launch of VR is going to be very dedicated hardcore gamers. They're going to need a pretty beefy PC. They're about $1,000 PC we've announced. And they're going to have to buy a Rift, which is not going to be an inexpensive, not a very expensive, but not an inexpensive device. So these are going to be hardcore gamers who are in it for the love of games and for the experience of new things, to be at the beginning of a platform, to be a pioneer going out there with the game developers and the industry as it figures out how to move into this platform.
Right.
And I don't necessarily think that audience cares if it's a licensed title. Having said that, if it's a massive license, it of course it helps, right? But I don't think right now that's necessary. To get to 20 million, 50 million, 100 million users, yes, licenses mean a lot. We all know that. But it, right now, I don't think that's a fundamental.
Let me pitch you on something here. It's like the Crash Bandicoot RPG. Why don't you go over to Eric Hirschberg at Activision and say, hey, Crash Bandicoot in VR would be really cool.
Crash Bandicoot in VR would be really cool. Lucky's Tale is very cool, too.
It's close. So you need the crash in there. You need the spin. The sound effects.
If we did a crash in VR, I would feel obligated to spend so much time on it, I couldn't do my job.
Just as far as art direction, as far as writing?
Everything. I have ideas with Crash. I mean, it's been since 2000 that I've worked on Crash Bandicoot, so it's been 15 years.
Man, do you go back and play those games ever?
Here and there. Every now and then some hardware comes out and supports it in some fashion, and I go play it. But I don't. They're not like part of my daily routine kind of thing, or monthly or yearly routine.
Which game was the most stressful to create back in the day as far as Crash goes? Yeah.
Crash Team Racing.
Oh, Crash Team Racing. Oh,
Crash
sorry.
Team Racing by far.
It really? Was interesting. I wouldn't have guessed that.
Crash 1, we had 2 years to work on it. It was incredibly stressful. Crash 2, we had 13 months to work on. That was stressful. Crash 3 had, I think it was about 11 or 12 months.
What?
And we got it done. Then Andy went off to start working on Jak and Daxter. Stephen White, who was probably he was a lead programmer. He ended up for a little while being the lead programmer at Naughty Dog, also went with Andy to work on Crash Bandicoot. Mark Cerny, who was not a Naughty Dog, but was always the N plus one Naughty Dog. If we had 50 people, he was the 51st Naughty Dog, right?
Yeah.
I relied on him so much, went off to work on Jak and Daxter and left me with some incredibly talented programmers, one of whom was Evan Wells.
Oh, nice.
But we had never worked together. And we had, I think, 5 months of R&D on the engine. And then we had 8 months and 6 days to put Crash Team Racing out.
Man, how the hell did you guys do it? What's the secret?
I still don't know.
Just long hours?
Yes.
Jeez. Well, thinking about Crash 3 in 12 months, it seems insane because Crash 3 is nothing but variety.
Yes.
What was...
We got really, really good at doing what we did.
What was the pitch there? Like, with the whole idea after going Crash 2, which is just great platforming, probably the pinnacle. I don't know if you'd agree, as far as just pure platforming with the Crash experience.
Crash 3 had the most variety and was most interesting. Crash 2 was probably, for me, the best of the Crash games.
Okay.
It was... You could debate this. Crash 1 was horribly balanced. It was a very hard, very wrong game in a lot of ways.
Right.
The way that the save games worked... Brutal. The way that the extra lives worked, brutal. And some of the levels were just not balanced. Like they should have been 10, 20, 30% easier.
Yeah.
Crash 2 got all of that correct. It got all the balance right. And it also was tight. Crash 3 was kind of, let's throw the kitchen sink and all the fireworks in. And if you like that kind of thing, it was a fantastic game. But it was a lot looser than 2. Wasn't as challenging as 2. I think maybe a little too easy. And it was an amazing game that you could get through and be really happy, but it didn't give me the satisfaction completing it that 2 did.
Well, once you had the Wumpa Fruit bazooka, is it game over?
Right.
Just walk through this entire
that's
game.
That's the point. So like what can we think of, right?
But why'd you go with that wildly varied approach then for Crash 3? What was the idea there?
Well, yeah, the thing with the Crash games is and this is true of every game Naughty Dog does in sequel, they always want to build upon what they've done but blow people away, right? We never rested on our laurels. There was another AAA franchise at the time whose name I do not need to mention, who by the time their third and fourth product came out, they were selling significantly less units because they kept repackaging the same thing in the box and it got stale. The first one did almost as well as we did. The second one didn't. The third one didn't. Our sales continued to go up because every time we went into the box, we wanted to blow people away. They would say, oh my God, this is everything we've done before. And then all this new stuff that's unbelievable. And if you look at Uncharted 4, like what they have to achieve to have that game step on the top of 3, 2, 1, it's just, it's insane, right? But that's the Naughty Dog way, is to say, everything you did, we're going to do all of it as well as we ever did, plus.
Man, how often do you visit the studio these days?
Not as often as I like, partially because I now live in the Bay Area for you know, Facebook and Oculus is in the Bay Area, so I'm not as close, but, you know, not as often as I like. And it's, it is Naughty Dog, and it will always be Naughty Dog, but, you know, there are a couple hundred people there, and when I left, there were 80, so it's vast majority new people that I don't know that were hired by, you know, Evan and Chris.
Did they all just, like, throw rose petals on the floor when you walk by?
Not even close.
All right, one
not
more nitty-gritty.
I should throw rose petals for them. They make me look good. Someone asked me once, they said, if you hadn't left, would the games have been better? And I say, how would I have done that? By nature, when you have the game of the year come out of the studio after you left, you did a good thing by leaving. You can't do better than game of the year.
That's true.
Right? So by leaving, I must have done worse. The best I could have done was equal.
Yeah.
And how do you do that? So I think I did Naughty Dog a favor by walking out and leaving it in better hands.
Interesting. Interesting angle. All right, I have one more nitty-gritty crash question. We have a piece of concept art here in the Game Informer office from the earliest days of Crash Bandicoot 1.
Okay.
And it's Aku Aku with a body.
Whoa.
Does that ring a bell? Did he ever have a body? And there was some backstory?
So I have to think about that. If you show me the image, I'd probably remember it. Okay. I know the reason we did Aku, we created Aku Aku, was because Crash needed a shield. It was too hard. And this, I think this was actually a Mark Cerny idea. It was too hard and it needed to be made easier in only the hardest parts without making it easier in all parts. So if you die a certain number of times in a rough segment, you're just that person that can't get through a segment for whatever reason, an Aku Aku pops out. And I remember thinking this could be a bird, this could be a butterfly. We went through a lot of designs and we realized that because this was a late addition to the game, we had like 20 polygons. Like, that's it. Crash was 532 polygons.
Yeah.
I remember that. I built him by hand.
Oh,
so if Crash was 532 and we had 20 something, whatever it was, for this new character, you don't have a lot of choices.
So you go with a rectangle.
Which is pretty much what he is. He's two rectangles, feathers, which are, you know, three polygons, four polygons each, depending on the shape, and a nose, I think. I think the lips were textured. I don't even remember, to be honest with you. But it was 20, it was like 20 polygons.
God damn, that's insane.
So if we designed him with a body, that would have been for some, when we started Crash Bandicoot, let me change the subject, last story.
Sure.
When we started Crash Bandicoot, we decided that we were gonna make a game and story interwoven as one. And we had all of these grand designs for the story. We had a backstory where Dr. Cortex came from. He was a genius that grew up in a family of clowns, and they made him put on face paint when all he wanted to do was quantum physics, and they put him out in front of the audience, and you can imagine everyone laughing at Cortex sitting there in clown outfit. We were going to do all of this in giant interstitial scenes. We were going to weave it in with the game flawlessly, and it was going to create story and game together. So probably if Aku Aku ever had a body, it was because that was part of the backstory or whatever, because I know it would never go in the game. We failed with Crash to get anything but the game in. With Crash 2, we had a tiny bit of story.
Uh-huh.
With Crash 3, a little bit more. Then PS2 came out. Now suddenly we had the tech. So we had a little bit of story, actually a decent amount of story in Jack 1. In Jack 2, we actually wove the story in and out, back and forth with the game. You know, Daxter gets a lot of lines. Jack has a lot of characters. With 3, we really started to make it a big story. Like, there was a full-blown story in there. There was over 60 minutes of story on top of the game, and it wove back and forth, and we do it in the middle of a level sometime. Like, it actually got there. If you think of Uncharted, that's the progression on the next hardware.
Mm-hmm.
Putting the story and the game together. The fact that it's an adult character and it's a human is irrelevant from a game design standpoint. They they took that next step to get the story and the game woven together. And that is effectively how Crash ties into Uncharted 4, right? It's the progression of creating story and game interwoven seamlessly.
Yeah.
That was always the goal. It was realized after I left.
As far as game and story, in a slightly more seamed way, not exactly seamlessly, there was that cartoon intro that was published recently for Crash 1 that was not in the finished game. What was that? Where did that come from?
Right. So we were off making the game, and Universal decided that they wanted to do a cartoon intro. And they gave it to the producer that we had at the time, who was not highly involved in the game. And he went off and created, well, you can judge it yourself. But I can tell you I was not allowing that to go into Crash Bandicoot, nor were any of the other people at Naughty Dog willing to let that intro go anywhere near the game we created.
I imagine you guys all holding hands like in front of the servers, like, don't go near this.
It was worse than that. We were told that it was going to go in front of the game because it had been made, and we had to pay for it out of our developer budget. So I remember walking eight people into the VP of Universal Interactive Studios office and saying, not for the only time we did this, it's eight of us, we're going to go home. You have to get that thing out, and we're not paying for it. And so that's what that thing is.
Wow.
Sony never, I mean, they may have seen it, but it was, the stories you hear about the making of Crash, they're not all true. That's the honest story, is that Universal went off and made that. It was animated overseas. It was abysmal, and it wasn't the character. I mean, you've seen it.
Yeah.
It didn't look any better in person then than it does now. It's not a great piece of animation.
Right. Oh, crazy. Interesting. So I like to ask people this, and especially people that have been around the industry for so long, who do you think deserves more credit? Who are some of the most interesting or intelligent people out there in the industry that you think need more of a spotlight on them?
It's a really hard question to answer, because I think that the truth of the game industry is that a lot of the invention and discovery doesn't come from the big teams that are successful that you know for the discovery. A lot of the invention and discovery, I touched on this earlier, comes from a smaller team, now indie. It wasn't indie back then. We were all indie. But smaller teams that do something brilliant that a bigger team sees and then commercializes effectively, does a good job of. But there are an incredible number of really, really intelligent people in the game business that are constantly inventing new things or coming up with new things. And they don't get credit because they don't have the budgets, they don't have the staff, they don't have the management ability, they don't have good design or good ideas, but their actual fundamental, whatever it was, that little nuance, was brilliant. And in a lot of cases, those people don't get credit for it in the end because nobody goes back to thank them. There's always been that in the industry. And Naughty Dog has always tried to thank the people that inspired it. I've thanked Miyamoto many millions of times. A lot of the design for Crash actually comes from Donkey Kong Country, not Mario 60 or not the old Mario games, because that was the model of level design that we kind of did. We went in 3D, and Sonic as well. I've said it's Sonic's ass game because that's the perspective. So you build up on those. But even Sonic borrowed from Miyamoto, of course, but also things you might not have ever heard of that Naka-san or whoever the designer would have played and said, well, that's brilliant. I'm going to put that in my game. And those are probably the unsung heroes.
And now you're just trying to seed that brilliance throughout the entire industry with Oculus. I mean, the most bang for your buck with Oculus would have to just be giving a little bit of money to a million indie teams, as many out there as possible, and just say, just go nuts. Let's see what you got. And then just come in and harvest the best ideas and then get the next layer going. Is that part of the strategy then? Or it seems like you have some huge teams
Oculus
on board.
Oculus announced a $10 million indie fund.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know
that. So that was announced. And that's not something that I manage. But Oculus is actively out there helping indies. And some of the games, for example, Anchar Wars 2, which we're launching in a few weeks on Gear VR, that's a team of two people that I saw the project they had made, which was a space flight simulator where you use your head to steer that nobody thought would be cool or comfortable in VR, turns out to be awesome. They're now up to, I think, eight people. They're fantastic. So that's an indie developer that did something nobody else had done, came up with something absolutely brilliant. They're called Oswi, and they're in Switzerland. And, that could end up being a massive team at some point. But right now, they're just kicking ass on Anchar 2. So there, a lot of the stuff is coming out of small indies right now. It's a good time to be a small indie because time and money hasn't given you an advantage yet in VR because we haven't had time.
Yeah.
Right. So the money, you can't just pour money into a month. You have to pour money into years. You have to ramp up, create a big team, have a big game plan, have a good game design, and then, you know, work that through to end up with something like a Call of Duty or a Grand Theft Auto. That hasn't existed in VR yet. So mm-hmm. indie teams are in this little window where they can compete based on simple ideas alone. And so it's a great time to be an indie if you're in the indie kind of VR game industry.
And you feel like Oculus has the support and the message has been received that like, hey, we need time. This is all the long game that we're playing here.
Well, we keep saying it. I don't know if it's been heard. I mean, at OC2, Oculus Connect 2, our big trade show, Mark Zuckerberg stood up on stage and said, VR is going to take a while to become big. In 2003, smartphones launched with BlackBerry. The iPhone didn't launch until 2007 or mm-hmm. so, right? It took a while for smartphones to take off. People forget that. He believes, I believe, a lot of people at Oculus believe, this is the next platform. It's not going to happen this year. No mm-hmm. one thinks that. It's not going to happen next year, but we think it'll happen.
Is it going to happen with this form? Or are you guys playing the long game of like, you know, 30 years from now, when we're just beaming it directly into our eyes? Or do you think that the actual headset itself is going to revolutionize the world?
The headset's going to transform over time.
Okay.
I mean, lighter, smaller, of course.
But still the basic headset thing. You're not looking too long of a game where it's not going to be neural network plugged into your brain or some crap like that.
Well, neural network's really far out.
Okay.
There are other technologies that other groups are playing out with, you know, projecting light onto your eyes and things like that, which are great. They don't necessarily exactly fulfill our needs right now.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what we're doing is the most efficient from a price standpoint, from a technology standpoint, way to get VR in homes now. But over time, there's definitely going to be a lot of changes to the headset. We all at Oculus, we all talk about the Ray-Bans, right? We want them to eventually be like Ray-Bans. Beyond that, it's at this point irrelevant to speculate. I'm sure my 2.5-year-old daughter will have some absolutely incredible stuff going on. I may not be around to see that.
Yeah.
But in the next few decades, better screens, better rendering technology to new types of screens, you know, and smaller, lighter and lighter headsets.
And you just expect it to be a glacier through the gaming industry where eventually it's just going to be all of gaming is going to be this way?
I don't think anyone in VR thinks that VR is going to replace the industry that's there now. We think it's going to change it, mm-hmm. augment it, give it new abilities, but there's no good reason you can't be playing a today first-person shooter in 10 years in VR, but on a screen that looks like you're playing it on a screen. Because as soon as you put today's first-person shooter into VR with the current locomotion systems, it becomes uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
You just aren't comfortable with it. You feel uncomfortable. You feel some people sweat, some people feel like just uncomfortable. On a screen, that totally works. It works on Xbox, it works on PlayStation 4, it works on PC. So if the, and they're great games. I play them all the time. I'm still playing them today. I haven't given them up. So there will be a day where those games are relevant. They just may be played in VR. Why in VR, not in a screen? There's a lot of good reasons for that. And over time, I think people will realize that. There's already, augmented reality is talking about the day where there's no televisions. You put a television anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Virtual reality, augmented reality, they're very similar. If you just have a pass-through camera, you know, VR becomes AR if you have, you know, all of that will come.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think there's any good reason to believe that today's first-person shooter won't be fun in 10 years. If it's fun now, it's going to be fun in 10 years, period.
Sure.
So it'll still be around.
So with the release of Oculus Rift, obviously Gear VR is coming very soon. Or it's actually out now, according to this podcast. But with the release of Oculus Rift, not like sales-wise numbers, but like what's a benchmark for success? What'll make you feel accomplished once that thing's out there?
We want to see engagement. We want to see the people who buy the hardware continuing to play it. And we also want to see them telling their friends how great it is. It's very hard to explain VR without putting it on someone's head. Anyone listening to this podcast, they'll get the Crash Bandicoot references and they'll hear the VR stuff and they'll go, yeah, we've heard it's amazing. Don't get it. Don't get it. Or I think it's going to be amazing, but I have no way to actually put that in words because I haven't put it on my head. The minute you put it on your head, you get it. So success for us is people liking it and putting it on their friends' heads. Because if they put it on their friends' heads, their friends will become converts.
What I always think of with this is, I mean, a racing wheel is amazing. Like anybody that's played with a racing wheel and played a racing game said, oh, this is 1,000 times better than a controller. But it's not exactly sweeping the nation. There's still that crowd that's really into it. I think with Oculus, for example, it's like, yeah, there's going to be those people that are super into it. I wonder if it's just one notch in popularity above racing wheel. Where it's like, yeah, it's a superior experience. I don't know if it's that much money involved, a more superior experience. So how do you cross through that threshold?
Racing wheels are for one type of game, only racing games. And that's a small number of games. If you're really into racing games, a racing wheel may totally make sense for you. But you're never going to take a racing wheel and strap it to an RPG.
Right.
It just doesn't make any sense. Oculus is a display technology right now, Rift, and an input technology in touch. Those two things are very inspecific. You can do so many things with a immersive display system that it gives you far more capability to entertain people than a peripheral that only does one subset of things. That's the same thing is true with if you compare it to some of the body tracking technologies that people have brought out in the past. You have to be dancing around to enjoy it. You don't have to be doing that much with Rift. You can sit at a desk with a Xbox One controller. We ship every unit of Rift with an Xbox One controller and play a passive game experience. Or you can stand up, push back from your desk, take out your touch, and do a first-person shooter gun game where you're holding the guns out in front of you, seeing your hands, and shooting at enemies, and it feels immersive. You can sit and play your Xbox games on the day we launch in Rift. You can watch Netflix. You can watch Hulu. You can watch Twitch sitting next to an avatar of your friend in a social cinema. You can watch movies. You can see 360 movies. And it just keeps expanding and expanding and expanding the things you could do. So unlike a device that's created to make one thing better, we're a device that's created to open up a world of opportunities and things to do. And that's the difference between a platform and a peripheral. Right. Why I keep saying we're a platform. We're a visual display and input platform.
So you can see yourself being at Rift for a long time here?
Oculus? Yeah, I can see myself being at Oculus and in VR for a long time. There's a lot of problems to solve.
Yeah, well, you got a lot of time to do it, hopefully.
Thank you.
Cool. All right, thank you so much for joining me.
Yeah,
really appreciate the chat.
Of course.
Cool, and thank you for watching or listening to this episode of the Game Informer Show. Be sure to tune in next week when we'll have anyone waiting for you. Bye.